In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May the God of hope give you the fullness of peace, and may the Lord of life be always with you. In the waters of baptism, Mike died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory.
May I be always.
baptism might receive the sign of the cross, may he now share in Christ's victory over sin and death. Good afternoon, welcome my sisters and brothers as we gather together to give thanks to God for Michael O, to pray for him and also to pray for his family. Unfortunately, these days we are not able to meet the family because of COVID. So, and also it's difficult to recognize you. You are wearing a mask, you know. I'm sure I'll see. I'll recognize you more when we get to the, as we get to St. Helens today. As we pray for Mike, I also want to remember his wife, Pauline, who has gone ahead of him, sister Betty, children Lindsay, Michael, and Rachel, grandchildren Ben, Molly, JJ, Nathan, Jake, and Chloe, and also the only great-grandchild, Theo. And anybody else whose names I should mention. I also want to thank all those who are standing outside. There's a bit of sunshine, but I think it's pretty cold outside. But unfortunately, we cannot let more than 30 people in the church today because of the restrictions. It's important that we listen to Mike's story, so I'm going to ask Martin, Mike's nephew, to come forward and say a few words, please.
Can I take it down?
Yeah, please, take it.
It is me. Is the kettle on? How many times, Michael, Lindsay? As soon as you walk in the door, get the kettle on. But whether Mike was your dad, your brother, your granddad, uncle, well, as Uncle Mickey would say, the man with the short and the whistle, whatever he was to us individually, Mike was the most genuine, loving, caring person you could ever wish to know. 58 York Road was and still is a very special place to me, and I believe to you all. It's a place where people are always welcome, always feel loved, and even through the most challenging times where life is lived to the full. That was all made possible because of two wonderful people, Mike and Pauline. And even following Mike's diagnosis and very sad loss of Pauline, 58 York Road remained special. Mike continued what he and Pauline created together and that we are all privileged to be part of. And I know today that we were there and we felt better at being where Mike and Pauline set that haven up for us all. The strength that Mike showed and how that strength, his warmth and loving embrace, lifted us all, defined who Mike was as a person. He was unique, and in all that truly matters in this world, Mike was a giant of a man. Mike was also a funny man. He would always put a smile on your face, he always had a witty remark, comment, always took the mickey, pardon the pun. But for all that, he never once laughed at any of my jokes. And he just refused to. And I'm quite certain sometimes he drew blood by biting his inside lip not to even smile. But I really do think at some time he did tell one of my jokes again, but that's maybe just wishful thinking. Mike treated all people equally. He didn't have favorites. He just treated some people more equally than others. Auntie Agnes, for instance, he had the poor woman deranged. Every time he brought in a hot drink for her, he pretended to trip and drop an empty mug into her lap, only for Agnes to leap up and cheer. You screaming is, you bugger, you got me every time, Michael. But she never learned, and happened time and time again, and that was part of Mike's character. Another part of Mike's character is his legendary DIY skills. So when asked, what of Mike's things you would like to have to keep, I said, I'd like to have his toolkit. And I've got it with me today. Now, to the untrained eye, this looked like two knives. But this is a flathead screwdriver. And this is a Phillips screwdriver plus a saw. It was just before Christmas Eve. These tea on over. Paul returned home with a real Christmas tree. It was a beautiful tree, perfectly shaped, very lush, and oh, how beautiful she thought it was going to look, all decorated, standing proud in the corner of the room, surrounded by presents. But unfortunately, when she got it into the house, it was just too tall for the room. And Pony still had some shopping left to do, so she instructed Mike, while she was out, to shorten the tree so it would fit in the lounge. Pony left, and Michael went about his task with enthusiasm. Upon returning from the shops, Pauline entered the lounge to look like what somebody had replaced their beautiful Christmas tree with Beecher's Brook. Instead of cutting the tree from the bottom, he took 2 feet from the top and turned it into a hedge. I'll relay the rest of the story over a couple of beers because I just can't repeat it in shares. What happened after that? Lindsay and I had a little chat yesterday about Mike, and I knew, Father, you couldn't sort of meet and give the same kind of background that you would normally do. And although everybody knows how much like Mike loves football, and especially in particular Liverpool, and I'm really chuffed that he did get to see Liverpool win the Champions League again. But other than watching Liverpool, Michael really loved to watch cricket. He would be as happy as pig in doo-doo, sitting in front of the telly for 5 days watching a test match. And he would have been really happy this morning because Ben and I were talking earlier on about how England beat India in a really iconic test match, because to beat India in India is something special, and that's what they did. There's so much to be said about Mike, but for now, I'll leave you with this. Spider, spider, on the wall, have you no scent at all? Can't you see that wall's been plastered? Get down, you silly. Good night, Uncle Mike.
Thank you. Thank you, Martin. Please stand for the opening prayer. Let us pray. O God, to whom mercy and forgiveness belong, hear our prayers on behalf of Mike, whom you have called out of this world. And because he put his hope and trust in you, command that he carried safely home to heaven and come to enjoy your eternal reward. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Please be seated. So we are going to listen to the scripture readings. The first reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians will be read by Kelly. This is Mike's niece.
If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. And now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, and the greatest of these is love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks. Now we will listen to Do Not Be Afraid. Please stand for the gospel acclamation. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my own joy may be in you and your joy be complete. This is my commandment, love one another as I have loved you. My sisters and brothers, the Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Once again, I want to welcome everyone here to pray for Mike, all those who are outside, and also all those who are joining us today via the webcam. I'm sure part of the family is not able to be with us, so we think of all of them, and we think of the connections they had with Mike, you know, all our relationships, they are very important. As Christians, we believe in a life beyond death, what we call eternal life. One reason we are here is to reconnect with what we believe and also what Mike believed as a Christian. It is important from time to time to remind ourselves that we are on a journey and that we are making that journey back to God. It's a time of grief, as you know. The grief will take time, and it's a sign that we are awake. Professor Peter Kreeft, who is a professor of philosophy in Boston College, who is a convert to Catholicism, he wrote a book titled Love is Stronger Than Death. There is a powerful section midway through this book where he challenges his readers, saying, instead of listening to me talk about death, he asks the readers to lay the book down and think of death more personally. And then he goes on to ask the questions, what will you think, feel, say, and do if you knew this was the last 10 minutes of your life? Now, it's not an easy question. I'm sure some of you have tried this question, if this is the last 10 minutes of our life. And we can come up with a list of things. Maybe we want to speak to people we have not spoken for a long time, and we want to thank God for all the good memories we have of Him. And maybe a few things that we could do within 10 minutes. But when you look around the world, we wonder whether people really think about death. I'm sure many of you watch television or listen to the radio or read the newspapers. There are many who are worried about how much power they can hold on to. And good example, what is happening in Myanmar or the former Burma, and what is happening in Uganda and many other parts of the world. People want to hold on to power. But we know at the end of our journey, we are not going to take anything with us. We are going to leave everything behind. It doesn't matter how much wealth we have, how many properties we have, we are going to leave all that behind. But sometimes we forget. So it's important when we come to a celebration like this, as we come to celebrate Mike's life, to remind ourselves we are all going to make this journey one day. And to ask ourselves the question, what am I going to take with me? As they say, the more we think about death, less frightening it becomes. So as we celebrate Mike's life today, and all that story Martin shared, and I'm sure there are more stories, we ask the question, do we live in a way that shows God that we want to be with Him? Is our belief in eternal life or life beyond is manifested in the way we relate or care for one another? Because at the end of our journey, that's all we take with us, the way we care for people, the love we share. The both readings today, the first reading and the gospel reading, reminds us that God is love. Where there is love, there is God. And I have this favorite line that I always repeat, I'm sure those who have been to church here or at St. Aidan have heard this before, that religion is about relationships. We cannot separate religion from relationships, because we meet God, God who is love, in our connections with one another. So Jesus, who calls us to remain in his love, invites us daily to share that love with everyone. And the Lord is not asking us, as I often say, to do big things, to do simple things, small things, to remind the people the kind of God we worship. Because it is the love of God that we share that we will carry with us to the next part of our life. God is love, and love is stronger than death. And that promise of eternal life awaits all of us, just like it's awaiting Mike. I'm sure some of you have heard the name of the saint, Saint Francis. It is said that Saint Francis had a skull in his cell, in his room. Not something that we want to keep in our rooms, you know. They say it is in appreciation of death, so that he may have an appreciation of life. Death is not something we get up every morning and think about, you know. We think about life. We think about what we are planning to do. But maybe it is important for us from time to time to think about what is going to happen at the end of our journey. And also to celebrate the gifts and the talents that the Lord has given us. And to see what we can share with our sisters and brothers, the difference we can make in the lives of people. Because we are all the presence of God here on earth. Because we are God's presence. And when we look at the person next to you, you are looking at the face of God. So do we live in a way that shows God that we want to be with him at the end of our journey? And today, as we think of Mike's life, I'm sure there are many things you are grateful for. There are great memories you have of him. I'm sure you will share that with one another when you are able to gather today, keeping the social distance, following all the rules and regulations, because it's important for you to reconnect with Mike. There are places you remember that his spirit flourished. And that is where you will continue to meet Mike. So as we thank God today for the goodness of Mike, for the difference he makes in our lives, we pray that he will always enjoy being in the presence of God, and that he will also intercede for each one of us. Please stand for the bidding prayers. This will be read by Mike's niece, Rebecca, and nephew, David. God, the Almighty Father, you raised your son Jesus from the dead. With confidence, we ask you to save all your people, living and dead.
We pray for Mike, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be submitted to the company of all the saints. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for all the family and friends of Mike, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for all the deceased members of Mike's family and for all who have helped us, that they may have the reward of their goodness. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We remember and pray for those who don't have access to basic healthcare, adequate food or shelter. We give thanks for their blessings, for our blessings, and pray the ways of justice and peace may prevail throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. Together in silence, we make our own special intentions. And we now ask our Blessed Lady, who stood at the foot of the cross and experienced the pain of death of her son, to pray with us as we say together, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Please be seated. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this bread and wine to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the spiritual food and drink. Pray, my sisters and brothers, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Please stand. Lord, be pleased by our offering and grant your departed servant Mike into glory with your Son, in whose great mystery of love we are all united, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. In him who rose from the dead, our hope of resurrection dawned. The sadness of certain death gives way to the bright promise of immortality. Lord, for you are faithful, life is changed, not ended. When the body of our earthly dwelling is laid aside, we gain an everlasting dwelling place in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with all the heavenly hosts, we proclaim your glory and join their unending chorus of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts. Please kneel down or be seated. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread, therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Malcolm our Bishop, and all the ministers of your gospel. Remember Mike, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our sisters and brothers who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all. We pray that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Please stand. Now we will say the prayer Jesus taught us, especially pray during the Lord's Prayer for Betty, my sister, Lindsay, Michael, and Rachel, and the rest of the family. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Peace be with you. Lamb of God, please kneel down or be seated. My sisters and brothers, behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Communion. I'd like to encourage you to receive communion. If you are receiving communion, if you could stand where you are as I come forward. If you decide not to receive communion, if you would like to receive a blessing, please have your arms across your chest so that I know you are receiving a blessing. But I would just want to remind you, there might be people who have not been able to go to church for a long time for whatever reason, or who have made their first communion. We don't have to be perfect to receive communion, because nobody is perfect. Just want to remind you the words of Pope Francis, who said, "The Eucharist is not a prize for the perfect, but a powerful medicine and nourishment for the weak." So I'd like to encourage you to receive communion. So as I said, if you would like to receive communion, please stand where you are as I come forward. And during communion, we will join in the hymn, "Old Rugged Cross."
Stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of
Please stand. Lord God, may the death and resurrection of Christ, which we celebrate in this Eucharist, bring our brother Mike the peace of your eternal home. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Final commendation. My sisters and brothers, trusting in God, we have prayed for Mike, and now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see Mike again and enjoy his friendship. Although this congregation will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ. Please be seated and join in the song of farewell.
Speed you to paradise. May the Lord and
Please stand. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend Mike in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Mike in this life. We thank God for all the wonderful memories we have of Mike. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to Mike and help us who remain to comfort one another with the assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with Mike forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. So on behalf of Mike's sister Betty, children Lindsay, Michael and Rachel and the rest of the family, I want to thank you for coming today to celebrate Mike's life and to give thanks to God for the way he touched our lives during his journey. We will remember Mike here at St. Agnes, and I also want to thank the stewards for being here. Thanks to all those who were standing outside who could not get into the church. And please remember, as we make our journey back to God, that we represent God's presence here on earth. So let us take Mike now to his place of rest.
Daisy, Daisy, give me your answer, do. I'm half crazy, all for the love of you. It won't be a stylish marriage, I can't afford a carriage. But you'll look sweet upon the seat of a bicycle built for two.